All right. It's always interesting, at this time of the year and at Christmas, when you kind of have, certain stuff that it just makes sense to talk about. And it's really challenging when you've been doing this for a few years and go, well, I talked about this before and I've talked about this before. And you guys might not remember what I talked about, but it's something I kind of think, well, no, Jody remembers what I talked about. She'll tell me, no, Brad, that's something you did 3 and 4 years ago and then 8 years ago. So that's the third time in 15 years you've spoken on this. She won't admit it, but she does. Well, today, I think we're looking at a new element of the Easter story, because there's so much in the last week of Jesus' life that happens. What are the events? Most of you have grown up in church or been around church for a lot of your life. What do we typically celebrate today? What's today known as? Palm Sunday. Why is it called Palm Sunday? Yeah, he went into Jerusalem, which was part of what the triumphal entry, and they laid palms on the ground. Well, and their coats and their robes and all this stuff, and they sang Hosanna in the highest, and it was a pretty cool, not just cool, but it was a neat celebration. But it really wasn't people recognizing Jesus the Messiah. They were recognizing, hey, here's our new ruler that's going to come kick out the Romans. Very exciting stuff. And we've talked about that before. But then that's on a Sunday, and he spends some time doing some miracles in town. And then on Thursday of that week, what happens on the Thursday of that week? The Last Supper happens. And there's a lot of neat imagery about Jesus saying, okay, go into town, and then, going into this room and ask if we can use the upper room, and you'll find it already prepared and all this cool stuff, which is neat and fantastic. And then there's the Last Supper, and you've been with me now for a fair number of years, and I love the account of the Last Supper in John. That's one of my favorite set of chapters in all of God's Word. Chapters 13, 14, 15, 16, and 17 are all Last Supper chapters. Man, we could spend a year. I could easily spend a year, and you guys would probably run me out of town and say, fine, Brad, come on, some other chapter. But there's all the encounters around the actual betrayal in the garden and the arrest and the trial before Pilate, and then how he gets shuffled from one person to another, and the beating of Jesus and the crucifixion of Jesus and then the burial of Jesus and his resurrection and the events around Easter morning. We could easily spend a year just looking at all the imagery and the fulfillment of prophecy and the miracles that happened in that last week of Jesus' life. So much happens that is so deep and so incredible. This is the crux of creation that happens in that last week, the fulfillment of God coming to earth to redeem his people through the act of this sacrifice of himself, really. I mean, this is all of what creation is about, is this week in history. And we could spend a lot of time looking at that. We're going to spend time looking at one little element of that that just jumped out at me as I was looking at that this week going, okay, really praying and say, Lord, what should we talk about today? Last year we talked about kind of the grisly nature of the cross. We're not going to go there. We're going to talk about Jesus in the garden when he goes to pray. We're going to look at two accounts of it. This is really accounted in three of the four Gospels. John doesn't even mention this. It's very interesting. John, the one that was about relationship with Jesus, relationship with the Father, he doesn't bother to mention this, but Matthew and Mark and Luke do. The Matthew and the Mark accounts are pretty much identical, but the Luke one is just a little different in a couple different ways. So we're going to look at two of those. We're going to look at the Matthew account and the Luke account, and we're going to look at this little instance of Jesus going to pray. This is after the Last Supper, so this is Thursday night. Go ahead and open up, to Luke chapter 22. We're going to start in Luke. 22? Yeah, Luke chapter 22. Yeah, the book of Luke. And as Luke finishes, his account of the Last Supper is half of chapter 22. He starts it at verse 1 and finishes at verse 38. So he accounted some, and it's interesting, the end of his account, if you look kind of just the few verses ahead, kind of in verse 35, Jesus tells them, okay, guys, you're going to have to go out and you need to be prepared. You're going to have to carry money. You're going to have to carry weapons. You're going to have to be on the alert when I'm gone. And then one of the disciples says, look, I have two swords. This is one of my just funny little comical asides. I love that. And Jesus says, okay, no, that's good.
That is enough.
It's there, right? I love verse 38. Lord, look, here are two swords. It doesn't say who that was. I would have loved to known who the over-aggressive, packing six guns. He had two. He was ready to go. And Jesus says, it's enough. Okay, so let's look at what happens after that. Verse 39. And he came out, he being Jesus here, and proceeded as was his custom to the Mount of Olives, and the disciples also followed him. Okay, so right there, what do we see in that verse? What does it tell us about Jesus and going to the Mount of Olives, to this place? He'd been there before. It says, as was his custom. This is a place that Jesus liked to go that was special to him. Well, we can assume it was special to him because he'd been there before. A place he liked to go to pray. Isn't that interesting? He had a special spot. Wouldn't you think that if Jesus had a perfect connection with God the Father, couldn't he just pray anywhere? Sure. Did he have to go to this garden to pray? No. He could have stayed right there in that little room and continued to pray, but he wanted to go to that special spot. He had the perfect connection with the Father all the time. Yet this is a part of his humanity, and we're going to see some elements of his humanity in what we're going to look at today. He knew what was coming was going to be tough, and he went to a place of comfort, a place of familiarity, a place that was special to him. What kind of places do you have that are special places for you? Maybe places where you know you can be separate and you can just find a quiet place to connect with God. Is there a place in your backyard? Is there a place on the side of a mesa? Is there a place driving around in your car? It's okay to find comfort places. When we know that challenge is arising, it's okay to go to a place, a special place. God gives us those that are separate, that aren't a part of normal life, to go and connect with him. I just think that's interesting that Luke mentions this was a normal thing for him to do. So he goes, the disciples follow him. Verse 40. And when he arrived at the place, he said to them, pray that you may not enter into temptation. And he withdrew from them about a stone's throw, and he knelt down and began to pray. Okay, we're going to hold on right there. Keep your fingers there in Luke chapter 22, or dog ear the page, and turn with me to Matthew chapter 26. Here's where the accounts, they don't differ, but they just give other details. So we're going to see here in Matthew a little more details about what actually happened. So Matthew chapter 26, verse 36 is where this kind of picks up. Verse 36 says, Jesus came with him to a place called Gethsemane, same place, Mount of Olives, and said to his disciples, sit here while I go over there and pray. Now in Luke, how far did it say he went? A stone's throw. That's, how far is that? I don't know. I can still chuck a stone pretty far. I don't know, maybe 25 yards, 30 yards, 40 yards. If I really try to throw my shoulder out, maybe a little farther. But far enough that he had a little privacy. So that's what it said in Luke. But here it says that he didn't just go by himself. I think this is interesting. How many disciples were with him at this point in time? How many followed him to the garden? Not just three. Three go with him further. But how many were there that went from dinner to the garden? They all went. All of them except for Judas. Judas had already left to betray him, to go find the Romans. So it's Jesus plus 11 disciples go to the garden. But in verse 37, it says, he took with him Peter and the two sons of Zebedee and began to be grieved and distressed. So who did he take? Peter and James and John, the sons of thunder, the sons of Zebedee. So they go to this garden, this normal place, and you probably knew that the disciples knew, okay, we're going to go and pray. This is our special prayer garden. Jesus says, everybody else stay here. I'm taking these three guys with me. And in fact, if we were to look at Mark, it says that he takes, it's the next verse down. Okay, look, so he takes these three a little farther in. But we see something about the heart of Jesus here. Verse 37, the end of verse 7, the end of verse 37, what does it say was Jesus' emotional state?
His heart was heavy.
His heart was heavy. His heart was heavy. He's full of sorrow.
He knew what was coming.
Deeply distressed. But wait a minute. This is the Creator in bodily form. He has nothing to be afraid of. But his humanity, isn't that interesting? That he allowed himself to go through the human part of this? Even at the emotional level. It says he was deeply distressed. He began to feel that. Now look at verse 38. Then he said to them, who's the them here? The three guys. Not everybody. He's kind of secluded himself a little with his three closest companions. And what does he say? He says, my soul is deeply grieved to the point of death. Remain here and keep watch with me. So does Jesus, I think this is fascinating. What does Jesus do? He gets his three closest and then he opens his heart to them. Jesus didn't just bear this by himself. How often do we do that? If we're facing a challenge, how often do we really open our hearts to let people know what we're going through?
Never.
Sometimes we do. Sometimes we do. I think ladies have a better approach to this. I think women are naturally better at sharing their burdens with their friends and their trusted friends. Guys, what are we supposed to do? We're supposed to be men, right? We're supposed to bear it. We're supposed to be strong. What a lie of the devil that is. If Jesus is our model and he was about to face the biggest challenge of his life, did he go announce that to everybody? No, he found his, not even to his disciples, the people that had followed him for 3 years, his 11 group, he didn't announce it to everybody, but those close three, he opened up his heart. He says, here, I am your leader. I've been the guy that has performed miracles in your presence for 3 years. I've risen people from the dead. I've walked on water. I can do anything. But I'm scared right now. Jesus opened up his heart. Men, that's what strength is. That's what strength is. So he does that. He opens up his heart. And he doesn't just say it's kind of a bummer. I'm a little depressed. He says, my soul is deeply grieved to the point of death. Man, he knows what he's going to have to do. He knows what it's going to mean. We think. We're reading into that. We don't know. It doesn't say. He doesn't say right here in Scripture, here's why I'm sad. We can infer. We can make educated guesses. We know by history what he's going to have to come through. But he says, man, I am afraid. I'm grieved. I'm afraid. He says, my soul is deeply grieved to the point of death. Stay here and keep watch with me. As we read through the next verses, a lot of has been said, I think, about, you know, the disciples falling asleep. We're not going to, they're human. It was late at night. They just had a long day. You know, it's interesting. The boys did this, you know, tournament marathon. They had to be there at O-Dark 30 yesterday morning. We didn't get home till 10-ish. O-Dark Dark in the evening. So play, play, play. And if you have ever watched my little Will play basketball, it is full speed all the time. He has one speed and it's 100%. And he got up this morning. I've never seen him get up and look so tired. He was just exhausted. And he didn't say a whole thing the way home. He actually slept in the car, which doesn't happen that often for him. He was exhausted, just mentally drained. So I don't blame the disciples for falling asleep here. I would have done the same thing. I've slept through lots of lectures. I've fallen asleep. I've forgotten lots of details. I don't blame anybody for falling asleep when I yap at you here. But it's not the focus of, that's not what we're going to focus on today. Let's look at Jesus and kind of what happens and look at his humanity kind of come out. Verse 39, and he went a little beyond them. So now Jesus has separated himself from the three to go get where it's just him, just one-on-one, him and God. And as guys, I think that's the step we like to go to. We like to, as men, we skip the part of bringing in people and being open and genuine. It's more easy for us to be open and genuine with God directly than to bring other people. That's just a little aside. But what does Jesus do? He goes beyond them. He fell on his face and he prayed. Well, okay, look at this. First, what's his body position? What does he do? Face down on the ground. I think it's fascinating. Does it say that he gently got down and laid down and found a nice comfy spot on the ground? What's the verb there? Fell. He couldn't waste any time. He's just on the ground. Okay, I've got to be prostrate. I just need to be humble. I need to cry out to God. I don't care how I look. What do you think the disciples would have thought if they'd have come across Jesus lying on the ground, talking in the dirt, mumbling in the dirt? Wow, he has lost it. Something is wrong. Jesus doesn't care. He falls. He gets as humble as he can, face in the ground. I love that. It says he fell on his face. Isn't that interesting? Mentioned he got just as humble as possible. And he said, my Father, if it's possible, let this cup pass from me, yet not as I will, but as you will. Wow. Here's Jesus, who had a perfect, intimate, all the time connection with his Father. Yet he didn't want to go through what was about to happen. He knew he could see future. There is no time to Jesus, to God the Creator. Past, present, and future are all the same. He was, he is, he is to come. He could see his future, and he didn't want to experience that. He said, if you can, if it is possible, let this cup pass from me. And then he does submit to the Father's will. But he didn't want to do it. I think sometimes it's interesting as we look at this, I think sometimes we feel guilty about not wanting to do something that God has called us to do. Because it's not fun. Or because it's painful. Or because it's inconvenient. Or because it's out of our comfort zone. Jesus didn't want to do it either. And sometimes I think we kick ourselves, we beat ourselves up because we feel guilty for not wanting to do something that we know we should do. We know that Scripture says we should do. We know that the Holy Spirit is moving us in a direction, yet we sort of don't want to do that. We feel, oh man, well I should want to do that. Man, what's wrong with me? Jesus didn't want to do this. This was the whole point of creation, the whole point of his existence as a human, yet he did not want to experience it. Don't beat yourself up. If Jesus is to be our model, he didn't want to go through it. He wasn't just, all right, let's go to the cross. Yeah, it's going to be great. He, like this. It wasn't like that. And I think sometimes we feel that we need to have that kind of attitude all the time when we're thinking about following the Lord, or thinking about serving Him, or thinking about sharing the good news, or thinking about, you fill in the blank, all the wonderful things God calls us to. We think we need to have a great, I'm going to Disneyland attitude and a set of emotions. That's not always the case. And sometimes that's okay. But we can't recognize, we can't stay in that place of having negative emotions. What's the last phrase? He says, yet not what I want, but what you want.
Is it possible he was afraid he might fail?
Could be. Could be.
He's human. Yeah. Perspective.
Is it really going to work?
Is it going to work? Yeah, there you go.
Yeah.
We approach God sometimes that way.
God, is your plan really going to work?
Can I do that?
Yeah. Good question. But he says, not as I will, but as you will. Next verse, he comes back, finds a disciple sleeping. He's a little irritated. So you men could not keep watch with me for an hour. Keep watching and praying so that you may not enter into temptation. For the spirit is willing, but the flesh is weak. We're going to skip over that for right now. Verse 42. He went away again a second time and prayed. So my Father, if this cannot pass away unless I drink it, thy will be done. What's he indirectly asking? The same question. He's going a second time to God, saying, God, please, don't want to do this. How often do we come back, or sometimes I get in the habit of thinking, you know what, I already prayed about this. I shouldn't have to pray about it a second time. Jesus went back and prayed about it a second time. And if we skip ahead, he went back a third time and prayed the same thing. Now, what's interesting is we don't have the God interaction part of it. We see later on, and we'll get to that, that an angel comes and strengthens him somehow. But we don't know what God's communication back to him was. Was it silence? Was it verbal? We don't know. But the fact that he came back three different times and kept asking. We see that a lot in our kids, don't we? Oh my gosh, do we ever. They don't get something. No, you can't have the donut for breakfast. Although I let Brody and I, we both had donuts for breakfast, so. No, you can't do this. No, you can't do this. But they come back. But can I? But can I? But what if I do this? What if I do this? We see it over and over and over. And what do we say as parents? Stop asking. Stop asking. But what about that own parable that Jesus said about the servant that kept asking, kept asking, kept asking. Since finally the master relents. This idea of continuing to pray for something. Jesus spoke about that. And here he puts it into action. He goes back not once, not twice, but three times. Asking God. Like verse 44. He mentions it. He says he prayed a third time, saying the same thing once more. I think sometimes we feel guilty, or I know I do, when I go back and ask for something again. Like, well, I already prayed about that. God knows that need. Yes, he does. But he wants us to keep interacting with him. He wants us to keep coming back to him. It doesn't mean he's going to answer. He did not give Jesus the answer he wanted here, and I think that's important. Just because we keep coming back to God, coming back to God, coming back to God, coming back to God, God doesn't care about numbers. He cares about connection. God doesn't care about what we want. He cares about his plan and our fulfillment in him. Here, he didn't give his beloved son what he wanted. Man. And Jesus still kept through. This part of humanity that just jumped out at me that I never really thought about, that Jesus came back. I knew he asked it, that it let it pass, but that he came back three times still asking, God, is there another way? Please. And how did it affect him? I think this is interesting. We're going to skip, turn back to Luke, back in Luke chapter 22. How did he feel after this time of prayer? Did this time alone when he's going back to his buddies and his buddies are failing him, you know, they're asleep, his three closest trusted companions. And he's going back to the Lord, maybe experiencing silence. Maybe this is the time when God begins to turn his back on Jesus. We know when Jesus is on the cross and he says, Father, why have you forsaken me? Maybe that starts here. And that's just me guessing. But the fact that he went back three times, and we have no written scripture of the interaction. Now, how do we even know about this? This must have been something that Jesus, when he returned for 40 days, told his disciples about. Because nobody's here to witness this. This is a Jesus alone with the Father conversation. So he must have told his disciples this in those other 40 days, or the Spirit revealed it to them at some later point in time. But there's another interesting point that Luke mentions about his emotional state. Again, his humanity. This is, we put Jesus sometimes on such a lofty pedestal, or I do, that he is the creator. He has no needs. He has no emotional needs. He is perfect. He is powerful. He is strong. He is everything. He holds all of creation together. Yet look down at verse 43. It says, now an angel from heaven appeared to him, strengthening him. Now, we don't know if that means strengthening emotionally, strengthening physically. Maybe he's just very weak. Maybe he was bawling like a baby. Maybe he helped him kind of put his act together. Because we see what he does in the next several hours and in the coming minutes is incredible. But look at what this was producing in him. Verse 44, and being in agony, he was praying very fervently, and his sweat became like drops of blood falling down to the ground. He was so... Yeah, here, I think that's interesting. The angel comes and strengthens him, but he is still so stressed out that his human body cannot handle the stress. So stressed out that the capillaries in his skin are bursting and he's sweating blood. And he hadn't even got to the cross yet. He's just thinking about what that's going to be. What that separation from God is going to be like. And knowing that he can't avoid it. That his loving Father isn't going to give him the do not pass go, do not, or the get out of jail free card. He's going to have to experience death in its fullness. And he is so stressed out, so worried, so anxious, that he sweated blood. I love it. Verse 44, it says he is in what? What's the state of being right there? What do your Bible say? Agony, anguish. And it says he was praying. There's a verb that describes how he was praying. What's the word that your Bible uses to describe how he was praying? Right there in verse 44. Earnestly. Mine says fervently. There's not much more of a word that says, you know, focused, passion, intensity, you know, everything you've got is how he's praying. Praying so intensely. And he's in agony. Now, thinking about that the creator of the universe is in agony over what he was about to have to do. That he experienced that. Again, looking at his humanity and looking at our humanity, that it's okay for us to go through times and periods or moments of agony, of fear, of being anxious and worrying. Four times did Jesus stay in this place. He did not stay in this place. He got up, he manned up, and he did what he had to do. He wasn't crippled by it. He experienced it. He let it be what it was to be. And it was not fun. I've been stressed out about a few things. How many of you have been in college and had a really nasty exam coming up? Or finals week? Now, I didn't ever experience that anxiety or that stress in high school. High school was easy for me. But college was really hard. And I developed test anxiety in college. I thought, oh, that's stupid. I'd kind of heard of the term before. I'm like, oh, that's whatever. That's for people that can't hack it. Guess what? I couldn't hack it. I did great with my homework. I did great with my papers, things I had time to. But when it was time for tests, I failed miserably. I got out of college with a C+ average. I got an A on one paper once. That's the only A I ever got in college.
Yeah, but you kind of went here to college. And the rest of us went here or even lower.
But the point being, I don't care. That your point is invalid because it was like Brody going to the science fair, okay? We got to the science fair and I thought I had it all together. And when you're in the midst of that and you are at the bottom of the barrel, you feel like crap. And I knew I would go every midterm, every final, I knew I would go in and barely pass and possibly fail. But I knew they generally did. I never got a D in a class, but I had to drop a couple. And I knew, okay, I can graduate C for college. And it was hard. And I couldn't sleep before exams. I would get nervous. I would not black out, but I couldn't recall stuff. Oh, it was horrible. Stressing out, man. What are my parents going to think? What are my friends going to think? And they'd never understood it. I found a couple of kids that struggled, and there was only a few of us. We should have had like the Princeton Struggling Club. But man, it was really difficult. Because I was outgunned. I wasn't ready. No, they were good. And I was not, I was not prepared to work as hard as I had to. And it took me a long time to finally realize, no, I can be a smart person. But I was stressed out. Other things I stress about now, I mean, what do we stress out about now? Taxes are coming up. Guess who hasn't done his taxes yet? Guess who knows I'm probably going to have to pay the government some money? Stress out a little bit. Stress out sometimes about, well, what's this going to mean for jobs? What's it going to mean for this, for that, for fill in the blank? I think it's very interesting, you know, that we have a very active president that's doing some things and cutting down areas of government. But what about the people in those government positions that have jobs that are dependent on those things? You think they might be a little anxious right now? What does that mean? Yeah, but what if it means they cut education and that impacts the budget for our little school? I do. It's interesting to think about that. What does that mean? But all the things that I've ever stressed out about, maybe I've sweated just a little bit, but I've never, and you have never, sweated to the point of blood coming out of your skin. I'm willing to bet you haven't. I'm stating that as a blanket statement, but I'm pretty confident in that. He was so stressed out. His blood pressure was so high that it burst his capillaries. Yeah. I mean, that's crazy. He is the creator of the universe. He could have stopped that from happening, but at that moment, he could not prevent his physical, his emotional anxiety was so much he could not control his own humanity in that moment. Think about that. He didn't just think, you know what, this is kind of awful. I'm going to think and imagine blood coming out of my skin. Great, this is cool. So emotionally overwhelmed, he could not control his human frail body. And again, I think, what does this say to us? That if the creator of the universe can have times of fear, can have times and moments of loss of control, even after an angel came and strengthened him, this is after that. I think that's okay for us every once in a while to experience that, but we can't stay there. What does Jesus do? Look at verse 44. After he fell up on the ground, or maybe he was still on the ground, up and down a couple times, we don't know. Verse 45, when he rose from prayer, he came back to the disciples and found them sleeping from sorrow. And he said to them, why are you sleeping? Rise and pray that you may not enter into temptation. And then we see, not so much in this one, but in the other verses where it says, arise, for my time has come. Is that in Matthew? That Jesus, even though it was tough, even though it stressed him out to the point of bursting capillaries, he still did what he knew he had to do. To me, that's the encouraging part. Is God's plan, we want to think, you know, God's plan is all roses and blessing and good things in our lives. And there are many, many biblical promises to that end, where God promises us his presence, where God promises us joy, where God promises us his love and his acceptance and his forgiveness. And that is incredible, and that's wonderful. There are even promises in the Old Testament and even in the New Testament about following God's word and being blessed with a good life, being blessed with a long life. And that's incredible. That's wonderful stuff. But there are times when God's plan for us is going to be painful and difficult and hard. And even as we contemplate it, there's nothing about that element of it that is fun or positive to us. There was nothing about this experience that he was going to go through in and of itself that was good. What are those things in life? What are the challenges? I won't even say challenges, because challenge is a small word. What are the painful situations that God has put in your life as part of his perfect plan for your life that you have to deal with? I'm not going to ask for you to respond right now. But if God is in complete and perfect control of all things, if Romans chapter 8 verse 28 is correct, it says God causes all things to work together for the good. Not just the pleasant, not just the fun, but even the painful things. That's part of conforming us to his image, verse 30 of that chapter, right? Or 29. Are we okay with that? Turn to Hebrews chapter 12 with me. Why did Jesus do this? We spent so much time a couple months ago looking at this, but just very, very briefly. What was his motivation? How did he get through it? Hebrews chapter 12, verse 2 says, fixing our eyes on Jesus, the author and perfecter of our faith, who for the joy set before him endured the cross. What was Jesus' motivation? What enabled him to get through this incredibly painful, horrific experience? What was the motivation that got him through? What was the thing? You can answer it by looking right here.
I got the other verse.
Okay. For the joy set before him. And what was the joy? Look at the end of that verse. He endured the cross, despising the shame, and sat down at the right hand of the throne of God. What was Jesus' joy? Sitting next to Daddy. Reconnecting perfectly with his Father.
Amen.
That was the joy. He knew to get there, not just for him, but for all of us, he would have to endure that. And that's what he did on the cross for us. You know, I like to warn, I felt it was my job to warn kiddos about this. My gosh, I got to be careful just to even touch this thing. That he knew that would get driven down into his skull. And he'd have to deal with that for hours. But the joy after that was greater was worth it. There's nothing pleasant about that at all. I bought a new ball cap. And I've gotten to where I'm kind of picky about ball caps. I'm kind of bald, so I need a little sun protection. And I was up at CSU and I bought a new ball cap. And I realized the really cool ones, the one size fits all caps that look awesome, they squeeze a little bit and they give me headaches. So I have to buy them with little strappy things in the back so they don't hurt. But I was thinking about that little squeezy headache thing is nothing. It's not that. It's not a matter of Jesus didn't say, I'm going to pick another cap. He took it. And he took it for you and for me and for his own joy of reconnecting with the Father. If we want to connect with the Father, we can't run away when he calls us into difficult and painful things. We can be a little stressed out about it. We can be anxious about it. We can be a little fearful. But we can trust that he is going to get us through. We can trust that he's going to provide us the strength to endure the pain. We can trust that he's going to bring us to a place of more connection with him. And that's what it's all about for you and for me. As we celebrate the risen Savior this week and next week, let us not forget that he had to endure something that you and I can just barely taste. How bad that was. So bad that the creator of the universe in all his power was so overwhelmed that he sweat blood for you and me. Just thinking about it. Whew. Man, he loves us. He loves us more than we will ever fathom. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, you are good. Jesus, I praise you and I thank you for what you endured on the cross. I thank you and praise you for going to the Father in that garden. God, I thank you and praise you, Jesus, for opening your heart to your friends. Jesus, I thank you for not avoiding what the Father called you to. And God, I pray for myself and for my friends here, for my wife, my kids, my aunts, my uncles, my grandmother, my friends, my neighbors, my sons, that we would trust you, that we would not avoid the difficult things that you call us to, that we would trust that your strength is greater than ours, that we would not be ashamed of our humanity, that we would rely on your supernatural strength. God, you are good. God, I ask that you would let us be motivated by the joy of connecting with you. Through blessing, through pain, through sorrow, through times of rejoicing. Through your Spirit moving in miraculous ways in our hearts and in our thinking. Jesus, you are good to us, and we praise you for your goodness. In your name we pray, Jesus. Amen. All right.